Hi, this is Mama Shan with a tutorial for you, and this image is provided by Dave. And the object of this tutorial is to show you how to extract an image from a background, and we're going to be using channels to do that and the black and white adjustment layer. Let me show you the original image first. Here we go. So we're going to create a new slip layer for the background color. I'll show you how to apply a custom gradient to add to the background. Also going to be showing you how to create density shadow layers pulling from the channels as well. And then just adding a curves adjustment layer to make the subject kind of blend better contrast-wise, lighting-wise with the new background. So let's get started. I'm just going to click on this original background and create a new image and keep this one for reference. So I'm just going to go duplicate layer and choose new document. So that will pop in here. And the first thing we're going to do for this image is to add a black and white adjustment layer. And I've been using this a lot lately. I discovered this last year, and it doesn't work on all images, but it does on a great many images. So we're just going to add a black and white adjustment layer, and when the adjustment panel opens up for this, I want you to think in terms of the skin color of the subject, comprised mainly of reds and yellows. And this is ideal, especially when shot on a lighter backdrop. What we can do is take the reds and move that slider all the way to the left and see how it darkens all that in one shot. The objective of channel masking or any type of masking is to separate the background from the foreground, where one is going to be completely black and the other completely white. Doesn't matter which one's which at this point. We're also going to take the yellows down. That darkens up the image area again too. And then we're just going to experiment with the other levels going left and right and see if it makes any difference here. Cyans, I'm going to move to the right because I can see that that's lightening up the background, but it's also lightening up some of the hair too as well. Let's see what the blues do here. Okay, blues up, magenta's down. Okay, magenta's down, blues and cyans up then. So now we've got almost a perfect silhouette. So we're going to come to our channels panel. And if you don't see that, just go under your window menu, window, and turn on channels. And we're going to look at these channels that you currently are viewing, which is of the merged composite that we see here in the image window. Let me just click on RGB and then go red, green. So I'm looking at all of these individually and not much of a change on any of them. So I'm just going to grab the green channel here and drag it to the new channel icon so that I have what's called green copy in here. Once I've got that going, I can come back to layers and I can throw this adjustment layer away. Don't need it anymore because we're going to come back in here and click on the green copy channel to put it back so that's the only channel that has the visibility icon on it. And to this, we're going to add a levels adjustment directly to further tweak this, as it were. So I will go under Image, Adjustments, Levels, or Control L on a PC, Command L on a Mac. And I'm going to just start slowly moving in the black and white sliders. I'm creating a little more contrast, but notice how that's blocking out a lot of the blacks for me here. Now, if her hair were very wispy, we might want to have a lighter touch or lighter hand in using this, but we can pretty much knock out a whole bunch by doing it this way. Don't worry about the shadows. We are just trying to isolate the subject from its background, so we want that subject independent of its shadows as well. So I may do something. I don't want to get it too rough going in here. That looks about right, and I'll click OK. And now what I'm going to do is just grab the rectangular marquee selection tool here and marquee a couple of these areas and fill it with white. So you can go under the Edit Fill menu, or you can just choose to fill with the current background color. Shortcut for that. Make sure, whoops, Just have that on the first icon over here. Make sure that you press Control Backspace on a PC or Command Delete on a Mac. And then we can just go in and just make some smaller rectangles and do the same thing. Control Backspace. Get that. Do it again. So we're just filling in these areas to make them white very quickly. And when it comes down here, I think I'm going to start using a hard-edged brush. So I will grab the brush tool and select up at the top here a hard round. Click here, deselect, and use the right bracket key to just make that a little bit bigger. Make sure you switch the foreground to white if you're trying to clean up this part. Make sure your mode is normal, your opacity 100, flow 100 if you want to just get this in one fell swoop here. Let me undo that. I got a little bit too much. So I'm just going to go through here. And there's a couple areas you can see that where some of the shadows still were caught up in that selection. So you can kind of tell where they are. And if you want to put this in Ruby Lith mode so you can actually see the image area as well, just click the visibility icon on for RGB. And if you have those visibility icons on in the channels palette as well as the green copy layer that we're working on, you'll get this Ruby Lith type overlay. And so in order, you can see where the gaps are here, and I want that to be part of the Ruby Lith at this point. So we'll just fill that in where we see those gaps. We'll look here. I'm trying to see if this is part of the shadow or part of the shoe, so I can temporarily turn that off and back on, and I can see it's part of the shadow. So with make sure you just have that mask, or the channel rather, highlighted in channels so that you can work on it. So with white as the foreground color, I'm just going to paint that away. And you can click and then shift click if you want it to snap if you're using a mouse. Or if you're using a Wacom pen, you'll probably find editing a lot easier, especially on these points. And here I want to click shift click to fill that in. And this is just a basic mask. We'll get an opportunity to fine tune this once we apply it to the image itself. But we just want to see if there are some main areas that we can fill in right now before we apply it and start doing some fine tuning. There we go. And I'm going to hit X here because that too is part of the shadow, a really deep shadow right underneath there. Okay, that looks pretty good. Let me hit X again here. Yeah, see the black in this instance is putting on the Ruby Lith. White is taking it off. So I'm going to shut those off and just look at the mask again and come in here with black because we know we're trying to just make a silhouette of this one at this point. And that looks good. There's another. So all the interior parts, you want to make sure that there are no little white areas. And in the white areas, you don't want to have any black or gray areas. So I'm hitting X key here. You can see some of that shadow here. And if you don't catch them all at this point, again, we've got another opportunity once we apply this to the image directly to kind of clean up and refine this mask. Okay. The other thing I like to do is grab the wand and zoom out a bit on the image and click in the white area. And if I see any internal dots that aren't selected, Then I may want to paint in there or do a levels adjustment. I also click in the black area too to see if there's any fragments or holes left in that. And there aren't in this case, so I'm just going to deselect, Control D on a PC. And now what we're going to do is invert the selection. Hit Control I on that green copy mask so that the girl is in white and the background is black. The white represents the selected areas. And I'm still seeing a couple of black things, little white dots here. So you may want to do a quick adjust levels here and just tweak it a little bit. Take the black in a little bit, the white in a little bit, and click OK. And you can also take your sampler tool, your eyedropper tool, and get your info window open. And I like to set these to RGB right here and just pan around the black areas. So long as those are saying 000, you're fine. And in the white areas, they're all 255, so you know you've got a good mask going here. All right, now we'll come back to the layers panel here. And what I want to do is convert this background into a regular layer. So let me click on the RGB channel and double click on it so it says layer 0. And then I am going to actually create a slip layer underneath this. Just go to solid color and I'm going to pick a nice blue color here. Click OK and then drag that beneath the other layer. Now, of course, we can't see the slip layer because layer 0 is on, but we can now add a mask to layer 0, whereas we couldn't when it said background. So let me come back to channels here and load the selection of this layer. The easiest way to do that is to hold down your Control key on a PC, Command on a Mac, and click on that thumbnail so you see the selections. Come back to layer 0 here that has the model on it. And we'll just call this model. And click the Add Mask icon. And so that knocks all that background out. Now you can zoom in and see if there's any areas that you need to modify here. And notice around this hand in particular, there is some more editing that we can do. And so we'll do that type of editing again with a hard-edged brush and make sure the mask is highlighted and it says layer mask in the title bar if you can see that, and zoom way in on it. And black is going to conceal, white is going to reveal. So those are the two colors. That's all you have to need to know to remember. And the X key is going to switch in between them. Left bracket keys making that brush smaller. And so with black, make sure your mode is normal and at 100%. You can just come in here and wipe away that little sloppiness there. And I'm not going to worry too much about all the other white fringe here because we're going to attack that in a different method in a minute here. I'm just running around here and getting the big chunks out. And you can see part of her fingernail also is hidden. So I'm going to hit X and bring that back. White is the foreground. It's going to give me the imagery back, going to reveal that. Using black foreground down here in painting is hiding that. This fingernail too. The power of zooming in so that you can see sometimes more than you think is being cut away. And you can't see that till you zoom in. X key. Fill that in. Let me zoom out a little bit. Uh, Okay. All right. So when I get a pretty good selection of all of this, there's two ways that we can fine-tune our mask. Now, if you have CS4, there's a new palette in there called the Masks panel, and you can tweak your mask using this, or you can use the old school method. I'm going to show you both ways, and so I'm going to actually just Control J this whole layer, and I'm going to rename this old school so we know that I'm going to use that on that layer, and this one I'll use the new CS4 masks panel way to do it. So I'm going to shut the visibility of the masks panel off because we're going to start with the old school way to refine or tweak the mask. And I have free actions on my website called Mama's Finessing Actions that are basically doing a couple of these things and more that you can use. Important step number one, highlight the mask. And the first thing that I'm going to do is go up to Filter, Blur, Gaussian Blur. And this is putting a blur on the mask edge. And I put about a 2 pixel radius so that we've got this nice white halo around all the edges. So it's smoothed out that jaggy white halo. The next thing that we're going to do is go under the Image Adjustments to Levels. And this is going to control how much gets sucked in and what the contrast is going to be. If I move the midpoint slider to the right, it's going to suck it in, see, like that. I'll put it back down to close to the default. Same thing if I move the black slider. This is increasing the black areas of the mask. Now, if I move the white slider or the midpoint slider to the left, notice how it's increasing that glow. And sometimes you want a glowy effect. That is another artistic interpretation, but I'm just showing you that that's going to increase the strength of that glow, which is actually the original background color. If she were on like a green screen, then that glow would be kind of green. So I want to kind of suck in that area there, but I will also want to check the corner and edges of things to make sure that it's not too unrealistic a contraction. So it's basically choking the mask is what we're doing here. Take that in a bit. That looks pretty good. I'm happy with that. So I am going to click OK. And so that's old school. Now we'll shut this off and come down here and we'll use our masks panel on this one. Now you have to have the mask highlighted in order to do this. So once that's done, you want to find your mask panel, which you can find under Window, of course, like any other palette, and just choose Masks. And there's a front end to this and there's a back end to this. And we're going to go to the back end first and click Mask Edge. By the way, if this is grayed out, you might want to, like it is now, you might want to check which thumbnail you have highlight, because this will only show up if you are on a mask. So click Mask Edge, and that will open up this dialog box. And there are several options to view your mask or your selection on different types of matte backgrounds, black, white, etc. But for our purposes, you're going to want to go directly to the first icon, which shows you a selection around the image. But then you're going to hide the selection with a Control H on a PC or Command H on a Macintosh. So hit that so it's that you don't see those borders, because that's interfering with what you want to do. And I would suggest setting the radius between 1 and 2. And so I'll just split the difference and do 1.5 here. Get that. There we go. And the contrast, I'm going to just set down to 0 right now and not have any smoothing on, and I'm not going to have any feathering on in here. I'm going to do that on the front end. But what I want to do is contract this a bit, and I may have to come back in here to revisit it so that white halo edge isn't showing anymore. And you can shut that preview on and off. So it's off now. You can see the white fringe on the end, and I've contracted it maybe a little bit too much. These are not by pixels. This is by percentage, so it's a little different. It's hard to kind of assimilate how much you need if you're used to working with the contract menu command, which does it in pixels. So maybe I'll do like a minus 14 here, and then I'll come back out to, I'll click OK, and I'll come back out here to feather, and I'll put a feather amount on, say of 1 pixel. And so that's kind of spread the mask a little bit, and it's looking a little bit fuzzy, so I'll come back in to mask edge. And when you come back in here and click on that first icon over here for selection, your selection should still be hidden. At least it is on a PC. I want to increase the contrast. Now, when I increase the contrast here, you can see that that makes my edge a little bit sharper. So I'll go up to probably about 60 here and, you know, maybe readjust my contract. Again, I'm starting to see some, a little bit of white fringe on here. So maybe I'll go down to about 20% and just kind of pan around. And that's looking pretty good. So I'm happy with that, and I'll click OK. And the difference is this is sort of non-destructible. We can come back in there and change these amounts. I could say make a feather of 7 pixels here where it's all glowy, and then decide, no, I think I just want it back down to 1. Go back to 24 or whatever. So it kind of is non-destructive, or lets you change your mind with these settings when you use the mask panel. And I do use that sometimes now, but sometimes I still just go back to old school method because it's been years in using that, and I still have what I consider to be a lot of control in affecting the mask. So there we have it. We've got the, I'll show you both of them too. We've got the masks panel adjustments here. And then we have old school. So you can see they pretty much do the same thing. The next thing that I'm going to show you is how to transfer a density mask to produce shadows. You're basically capturing the original shadows. So what I'm going to do for that is temporarily turn the mask off on this pixel layer here. And what we're trying to capture is just these shadows. So what I'm going to do is again open up the channels palette, and I'm going to click on the RGB first and then click on red so that I can look at this channel in grayscale mode. And what I'm looking for in here is the cleanest possible channel. Notice blue is showing a lot of dirt. Green is giving me a nice softer contrast and giving me still shadow detail, and red is good too. Red is giving me nice shadow detail and a little bit less dirt back here. So it's up to you. I would use red or green. Now what I'm going to do first, again, I'm going to copy the channel by I'm going to drag red to the new channel icon so that I have my own copy here to work on, and then I'm going to add a levels adjustment to it to further clean it up. Image adjustments, levels, and so I'm going to make it a little bit, whoops, that's the output levels. I want to go up here to the input levels, make the white a little bit whiter, the blacks a little bit darker, and I'm going to just keep moving in here. Maybe clean this up, open the midtones a little bit. See, I mean, you could go all the way over here and have a shadow like that, or just let the transition be kind of soft like this. I think I'm going to go with this. Now, remember, I'm not looking at the image. I'm only trying to capture these shadows for the feet and the hands. So I'm going to click OK on this. And once I do that, and while we're here, I can actually get rid of this one we were working on before, the green one. Let me go back here. So I'm going to load this channel the same way we did with our other channel to select the subject, and that's just control click on the thumbnail. So this is selecting the luminance of this channel right here, and what I want is the density. So I need to inverse that by going under select, inverse, and now it's selecting the dense areas. With that selection running, come out to layers, click on the slip layer, the color fill layer here, and create a new blank layer. And on this new blank layer, we're going to switch our foreground color to black. We're going to fill that selection with black by pressing Alt Backspace on a PC, Option Delete on a Macintosh, and then go Select Deselect or Control D or Command D. So you can see that we have, I'm going to Alt Click on this, we have captured the density of that channel, which has preserved the shadows, and the other stuff is transparent. And since this is directly and beneath the subject here, if we turn on our, let me turn this back on, so we have our masked image here, we have our density shadows, and this is basically sort of restructured from an old tip of Scott Kelby from years ago, from, gosh, I don't know, I think it must have been around 2002 or something at one of those Photoshop world things. He did it a little differently, but it's basically the same thing when you're capturing the density for shadows that are already existing in an image. So now we have this here, but what it's also producing is that original background. See all this mess here? Well, so what we're going to do to clean that up is we are going to add a layer mask to the density shadows layer. So just click, there's a couple of ways we could do this. We could, and probably the easiest way to do this, I was going to show you a gradient, how to do a gradient mask, but truly what we could do is just hold our Alt or Option key down and add a complete mask to this area, and then grab a soft airbrush and brush back in the shadows. I think I'm going to do that because that really is, I think, a bit more efficient. So I'm going to get an airbrush soft 300, normal opacity 100, 100. And so to reveal it, I need to have white as the foreground color and hit that right bracket key a couple of times. Let me get this out of the way. And so I'm on the mask. The mask is highlighted for the density shadows layer, and I'm just going to paint back these shadows right here. And anything I don't want, I'm going to hit the X key and remove. Black is going to remove what you don't want. So now we've got these lovely shadows that we can edit. Maybe get that out there, make this a little cleaner here. And that kind of helps us keep things nice and clean, too. All right, so we've got our masks layer of the model, our density shadows, and our solid color fill. If we want to add a little bit of pizzazz or texture to the image, we can just sandwich another type of layer in between the color fill layer and the shadows layer. We want the shadows layer, of course, on top of what we're doing. So I could come down here, and one of my favorite adjustment fills is gradient. So we could pick a gradient, and there's a couple things here that we could do too, just to show you. Let me just pick a black and white gradient here. Actually, let me do the transparent one here and change it to white, because this often produces a very nice result here. And you can even click the reverse button on this so that the top part is white. Let me get layers over here and see reflected. That kind of gives a nice look too. Then you can do radial and hit reverse or not. The other thing too, this is a white gradient, but it's got a black stop on the transparency end. So let me come in here and edit that too. Sometimes you want this has a nice effect, and other times you want to keep the stop the same color as your primary opacity. See, this one right here, this stop is controlled by this opacity, which is at 100% white. Now this one down here is a black color and controlled by 0% opacity, but it's still putting a little bit of gray in there. So I'm going to click on this color stop and just change it to white also. And once I do that, you get a very nice gradient as well. And we'll click OK. We'll check that out in reverse form too. And of course you can play around with scale, etc. And then in a previous tutorial on pinwheel gradients, you can figure out how to do this one and create it for yourself. And I've got this is going to just lower the opacity of this a bit just so it blends a little bit better. And I'm going to click in here again and show you that you can move this and scale it. This is in the radial form here, but the pinwheel would produce itself when you choose the angle style. Reach in here and move that around. And since we have that lower opacity on it, we can also come in here, change the solid color fill to any other color that we like. Go something really gauche here, pink and green. I hate these combinations, but I'm going to force myself to do it here. And you can, you know, change the angle of this a bit if you like in the position. And this, again, I show you in the pinwheel gradient video that you have to have this smaller fill box open in order to reposition any of these. There's infinite edges when you use these type of effects, meaning that you can move this as far out or in as you want. You're not going to reach an end like you would if you use the gradient tool on a regular layer. So let me just move that up here. Now once you create a background, you may notice that your image may seem a little bit too flat. It's not quite, you know, meshing well. So what we want to do is click on our model layer with the mask here and add a curves adjustment layer. And we want it to be clipped to that layer so that it's just affecting what's being revealed on this layer here and not affecting all the other layers beneath it, like the gradient or the color fill. So you can go under the layer menu at the top and say new adjustment layer and choose curves. And when this box opens up, it gives you this little checkbox which allows you to immediately create it as a clipping mask. See how it comes in above this layer? It's indented, which means it's only going to apply to this layer and not the layers below it. It opens up the adjustments panel, and basically you just want to tweak it by putting a point up here and then one down here, and just a slight little S curve usually does the trick to just make the image pop a little bit more contrast, to set her apart from her background. So that's it. We've covered a lot of ground in this tutorial, but I think that this is a lot of information that you can apply to images in a lot of different scenarios here. So yeah, this was the original, and this is what we ended up with. So have fun with it, enjoy, and see you next time.